In this video, you will learn 5 skills which every research student must have to succeed. I have listed these skills on this slide, and if you know what does it mean and how to acquire these skills, or you have these skills, then you are welcome to skip, because your time is the most valuable entity you have. But for some students who want a little bit of explanation, I will quickly but briefly explain these things in this short video. And if any one of you students can get something out of this video, so I would say that the purpose has been achieved. And we are starting right after this intro. Hello and welcome to my channel. My name is Tahir, and if this is your first time, please hit the subscribe button and also the notification bell to get notified whenever I post a new video on this channel every Tuesday and Friday. So I have made this list in an increasing order of importance. So as you go down the list, the importance of the point goes up. Now let's talk about the first point, organization. You might be a very smart or a clever student, but if you are not organized, chances are that you will not succeed over a longer period of time, because organization is such an important skill for research students. Now, here are some tips which you can use to get organized. So the first advice I would like to give you is that make a habit of taking notes. First of all, you should make a comprehensive list of what you want to do in your 1 year, or in your one session, or one semester, or whatever you call it. This list can be made on your diary, or you can also make this list on any of the note taking apps such as Evernote or Notion, Apple Notes or OneNote, anything, any note taking app or your personal diary you can use. You might think that this list will be a huge list. Yes, of course. And of course, this could be a huge list. But this is the point that you will at least understand and realize that you have a lot of work to do. On this list, you will put everything. What you have to do or what you want to do. Any appointments, any task, any assignments, projects, or whatever you want to do with your life as well. Put this everything on this list. And then what you want to do is, you want to make a weekly to-do list. Now, people have suggested making daily to-do list. I'm not a big fan of daily to-do list, because I think that we should memorize within a week what we have to do, what is important. Sometimes or teachers or myself have used calendar apps in the past. You can try it as well. So use calendar. So this is how you can organize your tasks. Now there are 2 more things I would like to mention here for organization. One is that I have seen that graduate students are checking their emails all day long, maybe 10 times a day. So you have to do something about this. So the best practice is just check your email twice, because this will affect your daily routine or your daily to-do list if you are using one. In the morning and in the evening, just twice you reply all your emails. And the second important thing is organize your folders on your laptop or your desktop computer in a way so that you could be able to retrieve the information as quickly as possible, because a lot of time is wasted searching in different folders. So you have to name those folders in such a way that you can understand, okay, this information, okay, I have to go there and quickly retrieve the information. So these are 2 other things, but there are some other things you can do to achieve this, but I don't want this video to be too long. So just I will touch all these points quickly. Now the next point is critical thinking. So what is critical thinking? Critical thinking as a research student is that you should be able to analyze the information and then synthesize the information. So these are 2 things. So what information? Mostly as a research student, you will be looking at research of other researchers, other scientists. So you are looking at the papers, journal paper, or maybe sometimes a textbook or some other things. So what is analysis and what is synthesis? So these are considered as 2 pillars of critical thinking. But before I explain this, one important thing is that you should be able to evaluate the source of the information. If you are getting something from a textbook, that is authentic. If you are getting some material from a journal paper, that is authentic. But if you are just relying on some information on a website, that is wrong. And these e-books, Most of the time, all ebooks are just crap. You have to evaluate the source first. Now I am assuming that you understand that the information you are looking at, the research you are looking at, is from authentic sources. Now you have to analyze that thing. So analysis means that you have to break down the main topic into its subtopics, into its components. And then synthesis means that when you have separate work, separate research work, or separate information from separate sources, then how would you combine that thing into a single conclusion? So this is you do in synthesis, that you first try to break down the main topic into small topics, and then you try to get information about all those topics from different sources, and then you try to combine those things, and that is called the synthesis process. So analysis is breaking down, synthesis is combining. So these are opposite of each other. So what is the purpose of this? What is the purpose of creative thinking? The purpose is to have a conclusion. So what is the story? What is the result you got out of all these activities? So this is how you should be able to do. So the next point is communication. So when we talk about communication, everyone tells us that you should be speaking effectively. But actually, this is half part of the story. The communication is a two-way process. So communication can be in different ways. For example, your communication with the supervisor, your communication with your research committee, or your communication in a kind of public speaking type of environment when you are presenting something in a conference, when there are 100 people sitting in front of you. So these are different kind of communications you might have to do. So let's first talk about one-to-one communication. The most important thing for one-to-one communication is that you must be a good listener. You must listen to the point of view of other person before you start speaking. So the listening is the half part of the story. So how will you check that you are not a good listener? So there are a few things. For example, if you are interrupting the other person, it means you are not a good listener. You are not giving the other person a proper conversational space. No. The second symptom of being not a good listener is that if somebody is talking to you and you are looking at your mobile phone or maybe on your diary or somewhere else, so it means you are not listening. And the third indication that you are not a good listener is that if you have to ask somebody to repeat what he has just said, and if there is a noise, that is another matter. But if it's a quiet room, but you have to ask somebody, can you please repeat? It means you are not listening. So listen to carefully to the other person and then speak. Then it will be an effective communication. So this is one tip for you. The other tip is that if you are speaking in a conference or in front of a research committee, then what you need to do is overcome your anxiety, because I have seen people, they are totally nervous, their legs are shaking. So how to overcome this anxiety? You accept this anxiety. This is the simplest way. Everybody gets nervous, no problem. You accept this anxiety and then say, okay, now I can understand this. Then you will be able to deal with this. Now the next point is managing stress. Stress is a natural response of your body when there is a task which is uncompleted and you have to complete it. So you get stress so that you could focus on that particular task. So this stress is helpful. This is not depression. Depression is a serious illness. That is something different. So if you are stressed, then you should understand your stress. The problem with the stress is that every person has a different response to stress. So I cannot give any advice to how you can recognize that you are under stress, but you have to practice it. You have to train your brain to understand that you are under stress. So a few examples of stress could be that you have to submit an assignment and the deadline is approaching, but you have not finished yet. Similarly, if you are studying abroad, you have to pay your bills, but you couldn't get a regular job. So you are under stress that you have to pay the bills. So in this situation, the response should be that focus on your assignment, go get an odd job, do something, pay the bill. So this should be the correct approach. But the wrong approach be that you just get stressed, you don't do anything and you can't do anything and you are just wasting your time. So this is a bad response to stress. So when you are under stress, there are a few things you can do. The first tip is that you should understand that I am under stress. The second thing is you should appreciate the stress and you should say to yourself, that this stress is trying to help me to focus on my job. The third thing you can do is think logically, not emotionally. So this is another thing you can do. Then there are few exercises, breathing exercises. Take 5 to 6 breaths in 1 minute. So this is a good exercise. Just take deep breaths 5 to 6 times in a minute and you will be relieved from this stress. Another thing you can do is try to understand what is most important at this point. Your assignment may not be the most important thing you should be doing right now. So if there is something else is more important, then you should tell to yourself, I am stressed due to this thing, but this is not important. I am going to do this, whatever are the consequences of not submitting my assignment. So this is how you can manage your stress, by talking to yourself, training your brain so that every time when you are under stress, you must understand and then you must appreciate it and then you must manage it. And now let's talk about the last point, learn how to learn for this digital economy. Now this point is very important and that's why I mentioned it at the end. The top skill here is that you must be adaptive to the new technology. Few years back, when students were going to university, they got their degree, they come out and they work for 40 years without ever learning anything else. No more. Now, you have to adopt new technology on a continuous basis. You are in a continuously changing world. You have to learn a lot of skills on a daily basis, I would say. So you have to have this skill that how can I learn a new skill quick, fast? This is the only way you can survive. Now the companies are asking their employees to get training every month, every 3 months. There are regulations around this. There are laws around this. So you will be learning a lot of new skills. So the best thing for you while you are a student is to acquire this skill of learning how to learn fast. This is the main thing that you have to keep yourself abreast with the technology. But there are few other soft skills associated with this and employers are now looking for these skills. So if you have to get a job, you must also be learning these skills. And even if you are going to academia, you will think that, okay, I just have to teach. I will go there with my diary. I will write down something on the blackboard and that's it. No. So as a teacher, you have to learn a lot of new technologies. This is the old way of teaching. Now there are many new concepts. Flipped classroom. You might have to create an online course for your students. You might have to use a learning management system like Canvas, Blackboard, Moodle. So there are a lot of technologies you have to learn, not only just taking lectures. So therefore, this is important that you understand that you have to be adaptive of this technology quick, fast. But there are a few other associated skills. And what are those? Those are, you should be able to understand the point of view of other person. You should be able to understand business models. You should be able to understand digital economy. We are moving from industrial economy to digital economy. So what are some of the essential things like media skills? You also have to have these media skills, not chatting purposelessly on Facebook, but how to use media for the business. So these kind of skills, these are some soft skills employers are now looking for. Even in engineers, they are looking for these skills. So these were some of the things which I wanted to highlight to you. So I hope you like this video. If so, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel because that will help me to create more of these videos. Thanks for watching. See you next time.